Divine True Spirit Discussions. These are discussions with people who have lived on earth and who have now passed into the spirit world. Jesus speaks to Jess, an earthbound teenage girl, through an intermediary, Anto Klobucar. This discussion was held on the 3rd of June 2014 in Wilkesdale, Queensland, Australia.
So what's the go? Have you been given any heads up about things today?
I've got two groups.
Yep.
Okay, one's teenagers, the one that from the previous time. Yep. And then another one's they're natural love spirits who are doing actual body work with people on earth. They're both earthbound groups of spirits.
Yeah.
So I kind of feel Jessica wants to talk.
Is the teenager. Yeah. So let's go with her then, shall we?
Yep.
I'll do it first.
All right. Okay. Ready? Okay. Well, welcome, everybody, to our Divine Truth channel again. This time I'm here with Anto Klobucar, who's actually doing some mediumship for us today. And we're hoping to talk with a group of teenagers who have come along to wanting to have a chat with us. So hopefully you'll enjoy the conversation as well. Thanks for your time, Anto, and
thank you.
See how we go connecting to our teenage friends in the spirit world.
They're looking forward to it.
Yeah.
On that note, I am actually quite excited.
You are, are you, Jessica?
Yes, I am. Yeah. You can call me Jess, by the way.
Jess, okay.
Yeah. You know, it's novel because I can actually talk to someone who responds back to me.
Yeah, that hasn't been happening much.
No, in a way it does, mm-hmm. but not quite the same way. You know, most people have to be induced or something.
Yeah.
You know, on a party drug or something. And they're not quite, they can see me and they can talk, but they're not quite sure.
Yeah.
You know, they're not there in a way. And then there's other people with them as well. So
yeah, of course. And then you've got to share their attention.
Yeah. Whereas you're actually talking to me.
Yeah.
You're talking to me.
Welcome along.
Yeah, thank you. Hmm. So, where's the party?
Where's the party? You want one, do you?
Well, I was told that
you've been brought to a party.
Well, no, not really. I was told that you can explain to me, or explain to all of us, actually.
Yeah.
More about
what's going
real
on.
Pleasure.
Yeah.
Because, you know, I met this young man, and then I don't think he's older than I am, but could be.
When you say you met this young man in the spirit world, you met this young man, or
This person came along to one of the parties I was at.
Yeah.
And
when you say party, it was a party that was being held on Earth, and you were in attendance along with a lot of other spirits as well.
Well, that's all we do. We just party
you,
and
you go around from party to party, do you?
That's right.
Your party crashes.
Well, I mean, if you understand, this is a great place to be.
Okay.
There's no whole bars, you know.
Yeah.
I can do whatever I want.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah. So, and we've been, I don't know of any other place other than Earth, but it's different to Earth in a way because whatever we want, we can do and we can seek all the pleasures that we want.
Yes.
And that's sort of what we've been doing.
Whereas when you were on Earth, you were restricted to a degree.
Yeah.
By the location or by your physical limitations or by money or some other limitation.
Parents and
parents. Parents is a big limitation.
Yeah.
So how old were you when you passed, Jess?
I was about 16.
Yep.
Yeah, at the time.
Yep. And you still feel about that age, do you?
Or I do. I pretty much don't see any difference in myself.
Yeah. How long ago was that?
I'd say about five.
5 years ago.
Yeah, coming on to 5 years.
Yeah.
And it was pretty restrictive, you know, when I grew up.
Yeah.
Whilst I was alive and I had a physical body.
Yeah. When you say restrictive, what was the?
I was a daughter, I had to go to school.
Yeah.
I was put in boarding school and
right.
The only time I could really party was under supervision or then we went on this excursion and that's where sort of I died.
Right. So there was an accident, was there?
The bus went over the edge and we basically all drowned. Then I was next
so
thing, you
know, almost all of you drowned together?
Pretty much all of us.
So what country was this in?
We were on tour. So we died to me, it felt like the Andes at the time.
Right.
So we were on excursion.
In South America.
South America, yeah.
Yep.
And, but I'm from England, so,
yeah. Yeah.
You know, and I didn't really get to travel much, but this was a trip of a lifetime for all of us.
Yeah, I bet.
For us girls. And
yeah. So it was just a group of girls?
Group of girls. Yep. Yeah. We all went to a girls' school.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. I don't think my parents would allow anything else.
Okay. You say that your parents were fairly restrictive, obviously.
Very restrictive.
Yeah.
You know, they thought, what's prim and proper? This is what I need to do in mm-hmm. life. And they had it all planned for me and I pretty much did it.
And how do you feel about that now?
Oh, well, now I've got the opportunity to do whatever I want.
Okay, so.
So I've been exploring. Yeah. I've been looking. Education hasn't been my thing at the moment, so.
There's an old illustration that goes something along the lines, if a spring is held down and kept under tension and then all of a sudden it's let go, it just goes everywhere.
Yeah, and I've become a waterfall.
So you've been the spring held down under tension when you're on Earth and...
Pretty much.
Once you passed, you thought you'd go anywhere.
Well, you can.
You can, of course.
Yeah, and there's no one stopping me.
Yeah, when you say you can go anywhere, though, you're actually referring to the Earth, aren't you? Yeah. Because you've been going everywhere around the Earth.
Yeah, I've just been visiting different teenagers, seeing what they do around the world. And
yeah. And before you passed, did you have any concept of what it was like life after death? Did you believe in life after death or anything like that?
No, that's what struck me. I knew I was gagging when I was dying and then
mm-hmm.
I was surprised that was the end of it. It was like, oh, wow, it was wasted. My whole life, really.
Yeah.
So
you felt like your life was sort of wasted by all of the restriction?
Yeah, just I have to study and don't really know what I want to do. And
mm-hmm.
and then to discover that here I am, I'm still alive. It's,
is that like, a bit of a shock or was it more just...
It is a shock
mm-hmm.
because...
So for some people it's a shock and for others it's not.
Well, it puts into question a few things.
It does.
And... But then I sort of forgot about it all at the same time.
Yeah.
Because it's a realisation, I am alive. Now I can now go do things.
I can live. Yep. And you haven't got the restrictions anymore of your parents and society telling you what to do.
No, there's none of that anymore.
So now you can go pretty much anywhere and do anything you like.
Yeah, and I could feel my friends. So I was like, bang, I went straight down and talked to my friends like, hey, I'm still here.
Yeah.
And...
Not many of them would have known that.
None of them saw me, so... No.
And a lot of them would have been sad as well.
Yeah, they were very sad, and I didn't really want to see what was going on either, to be honest.
Yeah.
And
your family would have been sad at your death?
Very sad.
Yeah. Were you present at your own funeral?
In a way, I wanted to see who would turn up out of my friends.
And what they talk about behind your back.
I don't know if that's normal, what others do, but, I wanted to find out, and... Man, there's some people I really thought were my friends, weren't friends.
No. You often find out the truth about your relationships, don't you, after you've passed?
Yeah, you do. Mm. I remember my niece could see me.
Mm-hmm.
That was strange.
Yeah.
So that sort of helped me realise.
How old was your niece at the time?
She was two,
mm-hmm.
two going on to three. And she could clearly see me, you know.
Yep.
And so I was talking to her and she was smiling but... no one else. She couldn't pass on the message to anyone else.
Right.
That I was still here.
Yeah, yeah. Mm. And probably would have got laughed at anyway if she did.
Yeah, but it was cool, you know.
Yeah, yeah. So that's the last time you've ever done anything of a serious nature?
Then that was it.
That was it, was it?
Yeah, I wanted to see what was out there.
Yeah.
You know, how do other boys and girls live out there?
Yeah, yeah.
And I just travelled.
Yeah. So you've been travelling all over the earth, having a look around.
Yep.
So where was the meeting where you met this guy that was not much older than yourself?
It was at a party.
Yeah.
I've been doing... I've tried everything.
When you say you've tried everything, you want to be more specific?
Well, you know, I've sort of attached to people and I've met all these other... All spirits. My other friends now.
Yeah.
And we... Wherever there's a party, they let us know and we all just go together.
Yeah.
And we meet other people, but we just go to wherever there's a dance, wherever there's, you know, something interesting, something where I can feel good about myself.
Yeah. So what are you looking to feel when you go there?
I don't know. It's when I was talking to this guy.
Mm-hmm. What did he suggest?
he said that I could talk to someone who could explain what is real pleasure and pleasure that I haven't really felt, you know, joy that yes. I haven't really felt.
Yes.
And he said, I'll take you to someone who, oddly enough, is on Earth. And I thought, oh, cool. So I thought, here's another party, really.
Another party. That's what you were expecting. Another
that's
party.
What I was expecting, yeah.
Yeah.
But you're not like that.
No. I don't mind having a party, but, but probably not the kind of party you've been frequenting.
No. Well, you know, I've tried everything. I could feel through different people what it feels like to have a drink and
take drugs,
have sex, and you know, all the things that I could never do before.
Yeah.
And I don't know. You probably know this. In a way, it sort of feels like I started to look for things more vigorous.
Yeah.
You know, more active in a way that.
Yeah.
That could start to satisfy me because it's.
Yeah.
I don't know. There's a limit to certain parties and to certain things. And
of course.
And teenagers don't do much at the end of the day.
No, they don't. Not on Earth anyway. Many in the spirit world do.
Well, I don't know about that. Yeah, but on Earth, I've sort of realised that there's got to be a bit more to it. So
sure. And have you noticed too, when you go to a party or you try to connect through somebody, that it's sort of like a dulled sensation? It's not like as if you were experiencing it yourself necessarily. It's more like a secondhand experience.
And that's right. Yeah, it's weird. You understand this.
Yeah.
It's almost like you try and push the person to do a lot more things so you can get a greater sensation coming from them.
Yes.
And we're sort of bouncing off each other, you know, all of us.
So you're sort of pushing the person on Earth to do more than they'd normally do.
Yeah.
In order so that you can share in more of the feeling because it doesn't feel completely satisfying.
That's right.
Because it's not really happening to you. It's happening to them and you're just sharing the experience.
Yeah, it's not me that's having the experience, it's them.
Mm.
And a few of us are together as well. So we've sort of now worked out we can work together on this person so we can all share on the feeling.
Yeah.
But then we try and get them to do other things. So it's not, you know, it's not.
Like, do you see that as a loving thing to do? Or do you just see it as a selfish thing to do?
Loving.
Have you ever thought about that?
No.
Can you see, like, if I. Let's say I was using you to get a feeling.
Mm.
Would you think I was loving you or being selfish?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I look at the person that we're with and, you know, they want to be having these sensations in a way, so...
Mm, they do.
So...
But remember, you're pushing them to go further than they'd normally go.
Yeah, I am.
Yeah. So, you know, when they drink, you're pushing them to drink even more and more and more and more and more and more so that you can share the drink.
Yeah, and they get more creative as well, so...
Of course they do, but half the time you're keeping them upright because under normal circumstances they would have been totally flat on the ground sometimes, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
and you're just keeping them upright so that you can feed off of the sensation.
Hmm.
Do you feel that's a good thing to do to somebody else? That's the question I have.
Yeah, that's a serious question, isn't it?
Mm, it is a serious question. No party here. No.
Yeah, I know. I'm just wondering what I got myself into.
That's okay. The reason why I ask those things is because true joy comes from having an experience that is in harmony with love and truth. And what I'd classify as the type of joy you think you're experiencing is really a dissatisfying sensation based on what I would classify as addictive emotions.
But
so do you see the difference between an addiction and something that's a real experience?
In a way, I sort of, when I was alive, I always thought that, you know, what people were doing, parents always warned me about drugs and all the rest of it. And I always thought in my mind that was an addiction, but...
I'm not referring specifically to the drugs. What I'm referring to is the emotions you're looking for. So, for example, the drugs are just an outward display of what you're looking for. So there's a feeling you're looking for.
Yeah, that's a feeling.
And you said right at the beginning of our conversation, which is a clue to your feelings, that what you're looking for is you want to feel good about yourself.
Right? Yeah, I do.
So when you take some drugs, what does it make you feel?
Euphoric, in a way you forget things.
Okay, so what do you forget?
The miserable life that I had.
Okay, so in a way, you're using these things to forget things. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's one thing that we need to just... And we'll come back to that. And then there's this aspect of influencing other people to do things they wouldn't normally do so that you can have a better experience.
But I'm not the only one doing it.
I know you're not the
only
one.
Everyone does it.
In fact, pretty much every earthbound spirit does it.
They taught me how to do it.
Of course, yeah. Mm. So, but just because somebody teaches you how to do something, it doesn't mean that it's the right thing to do or that it's going to benefit you in the long run.
But how would I know what's the difference? Because it's normal. It's normality, isn't it?
Well, the difference is on the sensation. See, the sensation you're feeling is not satisfying.
Now it's not becoming satisfying.
Correct.
Mm.
And it never really has been satisfying if you think about it.
No, because it's...
Because it's somebody else's experience. And
yeah, it's
your
not
own.
Like it's really mine.
Correct.
So the only
You see what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
unless you're having your own experience, then most experiences you have won't be satisfying. Do you follow me? So for example, let's look at the issue of drinking. If you're drinking yourself, that would be different in terms of drinking through somebody else.
Yeah, but how do I do it when now I'm dead? There's no... You know, I can't drink.
So this is the limitation that's placed upon you once you've passed, is that you can't drink anymore, right?
Yes, yeah, so I've got to go through this mechanism.
So you go through the mechanism.
Hmm.
Let's say with regard to having drugs.
Hmm.
It's the same thing?
It's the same thing, but it's a different feelings. You know, they're all different feelings.
They're all different feelings. And let's say having sex is the same thing?
Yeah, I mean, I wish I could do it myself.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's a great feeling.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it is. It's another feeling that I never had.
You're sharing it, though, with other people.
Yeah, and it's not intimate for me.
Correct. Yeah, and it's not a one-on-one interaction either, is it?
I'd rather have it myself with that one.
But you're really having, like, threesomes every time at least.
More than that sometimes. Now it's sort of...
Sharing it with a lot of spirits as well, isn't it? So it's more people that...
It does feel off, actually.
Yeah. So when you feel about it, it doesn't feel that good.
Yeah, it's one of those things I wanted to explore to see how it felt like, but... I don't know, I feel quite ashamed about it.
Yeah, and this is something, see, if it's in harmony with love, you wouldn't probably feel ashamed.
Right, yeah.
So this is a general principle of something I wanted to speak with you about, is that if something is in harmony with love and truth, we don't feel ashamed, we feel good doing it. And if something isn't in harmony with love and truth, then somebody says something to us and we feel internal sense of shame. So that's an indication of our conscience, is it? That's our conscience bothering us. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I agree.
Mm. Yeah. So partly one of the reasons why you're not having as much joy is because your conscience is bothering you.
Yeah, true. Does
that make sense?
I do agree with you.
Yeah.
Mm.
Now you haven't been that conscious. You haven't been that aware that your conscience has been bothering you because you've just gone from party to party to party to party, right?
Mm.
But now that you just sort of sit down and think about it, you can feel, yeah, that doesn't feel that good really, like... With regard to sex, you are in the spirit world able to have a sexual relationship with somebody without having it through somebody on earth. So you're able to have a sexual relationship with another person in the spirit world.
But none of the people I'm with know that.
No, I know. And so why don't they know that? So that's the question.
I don't know.
Can you see when you first passed, there was that initial passing where you had a lot of questions, like one or, you know, quite a number of different questions. But very rapidly what happened was you were drawn to parties and then it's almost like you forgot all your questions.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah?
Mm.
And you haven't for 5 years asked a lot of those questions, but they were questions that you had right at the beginning.
It's almost like time passed really quickly.
Time is passing really quick. And the reason why it's passing is because you are meeting your emotional addictions.
Why do you call it an addiction?
Well, it's an addiction when we're not receiving any joy from it, but we feel drawn to do it. In other words, we feel like we have to do it.
Yeah, like I feel compelled.
So you feel compelled to go to these parties.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? And that means that you're being driven by some feeling inside of you that you're avoiding.
Yeah, things that I've missed out on.
No, it's not just things you've missed out on. It's also feelings that you've missed out on. So no, it's not just events that you've missed out on, but feelings. So for example, when you were growing up, you were never given a sense of freedom, for example.
No.
You always had somebody controlling you, someone telling you what to do.
Yeah.
You know, if it wasn't mum and dad, it was the school. If it wasn't the school, then it was your other girlfriends. And, you know, you did things as a group, but you never really did anything for yourself.
Well, no. The only time I had for myself was when I'm stuck in my own room studying.
Yeah, and that was forced upon you. It's not something you really wanted to do either.
Yeah.
Right? And so if you think about it, partly one of the reasons why you've been doing what you've been doing for the last 5 years is because you like the sense of freedom it gave you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Look, I'm not going to deny that because it's true.
Yeah. So the sense of freedom is a feeling that you want because you didn't have it when you're on Earth.
Yeah, because, I mean, I don't like what happens on Earth in a way. We are restricted so much, so we can't experience things.
That's very true. We are. We're restricted far too much. By most people, and usually by our parents, it usually starts there, right?
So what do they expect if, you know, I get my first chance and it's...
Of course. So this is what happens with many teenagers who die and pass over into the spirit world. They get their chance to experience things they've never experienced, so off they go and experience them all.
And I sort of thought I was helping the others as well. Well, so they're not restricted.
Yeah, but you're not necessarily helping them because for a lot of them, as you know, they're having to share the experience.
Yeah.
With a whole group of spirits.
I mean, it's my main motive to share the experience for myself.
Yeah.
You know, to have the experience. So I can see the person wants to, so I help them.
Yeah.
So that's not, you know, my primary goal in a way.
Yeah. So, but in the process, you've found that every time you've shared the experience, it's like you're not, it's sort of like a numbed experience. It's not like a really pleasurable experience.
And why is that? Like... It is interesting that feelings can come from a person through to me.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't, like, no matter how close I get to the person, it still doesn't feel like it's me. You know, it's not a direct experience.
Well, that's because that person who you're interacting with is not conscious that you're there. And since they're not conscious that you're there...
Are you sure?
Well, in a purely conscious manner, they're either drugged or drunk. You know, most of...
Yeah.
As you said, this is the first conversation you've had with somebody who isn't drugged or drunk.
Or drunk
in order to have a conversation. And it feels quite good, right?
Yeah, it does.
Because it feels a lot more satisfying. Hmm. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, like you're actually having a dialogue.
Exactly. You actually have an interaction with somebody who knows you're there and thus talking to you specifically, not to you generally, to a group of you generally.
And you can sort of feel me in a way as a person.
Correct, yeah.
The other person doesn't feel that.
No, and that's also is dissatisfying, isn't it? Because because they don't really know who they're interacting with.
Yeah, that could be, I mean, it can be boys and girls at the same time, you know.
Exactly. They've got no idea.
They've got no idea what they're feeling.
No. Mm. And that's the sad thing if you think about it in a way, because it means that everybody is having a fairly numb experience. They're not really aware of really what's going on. And I put to you that if you're going to ever have real joy in anything, you've got to be completely aware. Awareness is a very important part. And that means that every person who experiences the experience needs to be aware.
I'm confused. What do you mean by being aware? Like, I'm aware that I'm with this person and trying to get these feelings.
Yes, but you're not aware of why you're trying to get the feelings. You're also not aware...
I want to feel good.
Yeah, but it's not that simple. You're not aware of the real reasons.
Oh, right.
Right? They are not aware of your presence.
No, they're not.
So they can't actually give you directly their feelings because they're not aware of your presence. So you're only receiving the feelings secondhand. You're only receiving them like as a... You could say as a... through the filters of their awareness.
Yeah, not like now when I'm talking to you.
Correct. Now this kind of discussion can be a much more direct discussion, can't it? Because I'm aware that who I'm talking to, you're aware of who you're talking to.
Mm.
Both of us are aware.
Yeah.
Okay. And so there's a flow of more direct in feelings. Does that make sense? Between the two of us as a result.
So if I'm not aware of why I was with that person, as you say...
Mm-hmm.
Then in a way, I'm not even aware why I'm talking to you.
Well, you told me why you were talking to me. But really, if you get down to it,
the reason why you're talking to me, I could probably explain to you better than you can explain to yourself.
Yeah, how's that possible?
Well, because I can feel more of what's going on for you than you can feel. So if I give you an illustration of that. What attracted you to the man who came to speak with you about real joy?
He's happy in a real way.
Okay.
And like he says that he knows how... He says that it's he understands what I'm feeling.
Because mm-hmm. he's been there.
He's been there, yeah. And he said there's a better place
yeah.
where you can really feel...
True
joy.
Joy, yeah.
And we're saying like, oh, yeah, no worries, let's all go.
Yep.
And he said, but you have to come in with me and I'll introduce you to a person who can explain it. But he's on earth.
Yeah.
So that intrigued me.
Well, it was easier for him to bring you to me rather than it was for him to explain it to you, because at the moment there's still a lot of connections you have to earth and you don't have that many connections to what he could possibly explain to you at this point. And this is what he's trying to address. Does that make sense?
Hmm.
Also, what he's trying to suggest to you is that every time you have these detuned experiences, you will either do one of two things. You will either try to influence the person on earth to have a darker experience, to do more that's actually against their own happiness.
So you call that a dark feeling?
Yeah. If I can give you an example. Have you noticed that every single time you've done this with a person on earth, have you ever looked at yourself in the mirror?
No. I'm just being focused on the feeling.
Exactly. When you come away from the experience, have you noticed that it's progressively getting harder for you to feel good about it?
Yeah, it feels more empty, like I've got to strive for more to try and feel the same thing.
Correct. And this is part of the problem, you see. To do more, you've got to influence the person on earth to do more, and then they do start doing things they don't really want to do.
Mm.
And you're influencing them to do things they don't really want.
And it takes more of us to do that too.
Of course it does. And then, of course, you feel less satisfied because your conscience is going to bother you more.
Mm.
And so at the moment you're in this cycle that's slowly heading down into more and more sadness.
Mm, yeah, I can sort of...
So if you think about your enthusiasm for what you're doing 5 years ago...
Oh, it's not the same.
It's not the same as now, is it?
No.
Now you're not as enthusiastic about doing it.
And the feelings don't feel that great, to be honest.
Correct. They're not feeling as good as they felt 5 years ago.
No. It's like the euphoria has capped itself, but
mm-hmm.
in a strange way, the euphoria feels empty.
It is
empty. It's starting to feel empty.
Yeah, it will feel empty. And the reason why, there's a lot of reasons why. One of the reasons is because the more that you go down this track of trying to influence others against their own will... you are becoming the type of persons that your parents were.
Oh, no.
That's what you're doing.
Yeah, but they're stiff, you know.
Yeah, but all you're doing is doing it in a different direction.
But they don't feel like that. They never felt happy. They just felt...
True, but there must have been some reason why they tried to control your will. And see, what you're not doing is you're not seeing the correlation. Every time you try to control another person's will, your happiness will go down.
Oh, right. Like what they did to me.
Correct.
But I don't know why they did it to me. Like what you're saying that really they had matter?
They had a reason, whatever that reason was. I'm not saying it was valid.
Oh, you're just saying it's because they did that to me and now I'm doing the same thing to another.
To others.
What, because I learned that from them?
Well, not only because you learned it from them, but because you're being very self-absorbed. You only see it from your own perspective.
Yeah, because I've had no...
And isn't that what your parents did with you? Aren't they just seeing things from their own perspective?
It's like every time I say but, it's like you make me feel worse.
Well, I'm not trying to make you feel worse. What I'm trying to do is help you see the truth of what's happening. You see, the truth of what's happening, and I can feel this has been happening for you, is that over the last 5 years, when you first entered the spirit world, you thought you had a few questions initially, but you ignored them, and then you went on this, shall we call it a spree? Should we call it that?
Yeah.
You went on this spree, but in the process of going on this spree and the search for happiness, you have become more unhappy than when you first arrived.
But how do you learn if you're yearning for feelings
yeah.
and you get the opportunity to feel, isn't that part of the process of growing?
It is, as long as the learning is actually in harmony with truth and love, then certainly I would say that's true, what you said is true. But if the learning's out of harmony with love, and I'm suggesting to you that the learning you've been doing so far has been out of harmony with love, and it's always going to cause more unhappiness.
But it depends on how you define what's in harmony with truth and love. I mean, whose measurements are you using?
God's.
Who's God?
God exists, and God created the entire universe, and God set up all of the measurements. And that's what you haven't learned. And not learning that is a very important part of what you're now experiencing. You see, in the process of not learning that, you've engaged in an experience where your happiness, shall we call it, has slowly getting worse.
Yeah, I can see the happiness.
Can you see? It's slowly degrading. In other words, you when you first began, you thought it was quite good to do all of these things. But then as you've taken the decisions and made the choices you've made, many of them are the same kinds of choices your parents made before you, in that they imposed themselves upon you and caused you to do things you didn't want to do so that they could receive some joy.
Were they getting joy from doing that to me?
Well, they must have, otherwise they wouldn't have done it. Or you could say they were preventing their own fears, right? But either way, it's a resistance to certain sad emotions that they had that caused them to do what they did to you. And now you're doing the same with others. In that there's emotions inside of you that you're resisting that caused you to want fulfillment of certain feelings.
But they didn't stop controlling me, whereas I'm starting to feel different.
Who can stop controlling you?
My parents didn't stop. They kept carrying on whilst I was
alive. True, I agree, they were totally wrong.
So were they having a change in their feelings at that time? Or?
No, they weren't. This is the trouble with what happens with many parents on earth, is they're not self-reflective. See, what I'm trying to do is encourage you to be self-reflective.
You're making me think about a lot of stuff.
And that's not what your parents are. Your parents are not self-reflective. So I'm trying to encourage you to do something that your parents haven't done for themselves.
Okay. So in a way, are you saying that I have started to be, what do you call it, self-reflective?
Yeah.
Because in my feelings.
Yeah, because you're starting to realise that every time you take an action that influences somebody on earth, you're not getting as much happiness as you was before.
Yeah, I admit that.
And this is why your friend in the spirit world said to you, look, it's not the right way to get joy. Because eventually he knows that eventually if you keep going down this road, you're going to become sadder and sadder. And eventually you can become sad and angry and depressed. And do you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, I don't want to do that.
That's the road you're leading down. And your conscience is going to bother you immensely once you stop, because you realize that the reason why you influenced many people was because you were just being selfish with them. You wanted them to do things so that you could get things.
I don't like when you say that.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, I do admit, it is my motive to feel happy. Well, now you're questioning my happiness, but...
Well, you don't feel very happy to me. You feel like you're meeting some addictions, and I understand why you have them. And I feel these addictions are emotional. They're not just physical. They're not your addictions to drugs or drink, or those are just the outward show of what you're really addicted to, which is you want to feel good about yourself because you actually don't feel very good about yourself. Yeah. Nobody on earth ever made you feel really good about yourself.
No.
And nobody, the way your parents treated you, they basically bossed you around, told you what to do. That doesn't make you feel very good about yourself.
But those feelings don't feel nice. And
I agree.
I grew up with all of that. Why do I need to keep feeling that stuff?
Well, you don't need to keep feeling it. But can I make a suggestion to you? Feelings either pass through you or they stop inside of you. Do you understand what I mean by that?
In a way, I mean, none of these feelings that I've felt over the 5 years have sort of stayed with me.
Yeah.
So is that what you mean?
So they've all passed through you.
Yeah, is that what you mean?
Yeah. Now, there's certain feelings in you that you haven't let pass through you.
No, all those...
All those sad feelings, right?
Yeah, they're with me.
So. They're with you. Now, it's like if you could imagine a big bag and you've got all of those feelings stuffed in that bag.
Yeah, and I'm trying to...
And you're carrying them.
Yeah.
On your back.
And I'm trying to substitute those feelings for, sort of get rid of them by feeling...
By feeling other things.
Yeah.
That's called an addiction. And what I'm suggesting is...
But why wouldn't that be loving?
Well, substitution never gets rid of the feelings. The feelings are still there, right? That's the problem. You need to have a way of getting rid of the feelings for good.
Yeah.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, but I didn't realise until I started talking to you...
That was possible.
Yeah, even I had those negative feelings. I thought they were already gone.
Yeah, they're not already gone, because otherwise if we talk and you feel sad, you wouldn't feel sad anymore, would you?
Yeah, and then you're bringing them up.
Yeah. Now, not bringing them up, I am just showing you that they're still within you. Because if I could talk about these things, and if they weren't within you, you wouldn't feel them.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
It's hard to argue against that, because I can feel it now.
Yeah, and you can feel how raw they are, right?
Yeah, they're just like they've never left me.
Okay, so they've been from the earth and they've not left you yet. And what I'm suggesting to you is the only way to become completely happy is for those feelings to actually leave you.
But I've tried over the last 5 years.
No, you've only tried having the addiction met. You've tried substitution. Do you understand? You've tried substituting one feeling for another. You haven't tried making the original feeling leave.
So are you saying that my friend,
yeah,
you know what my friend's done?
Yes. He'll confirm that with you if you want to talk with him about it.
Yeah, no, he's here. He's helping us.
Yeah. What he had to do is he had to go through the fact that what he found out was this, and it's the truth that you're starting to find out, and that is every time that you, right, decide to try to substitute a feeling, that it's never going to work out good. So he knows that. He also found that no matter how much he tried to substitute the feeling, the underlying feeling still remained.
But how did he... In a way, he knows what I felt, what I feel right now.
He knows what you feel because he's been through a lot of that pain himself. He doesn't feel it anymore because he's let it go using a different process. See, he learnt through that process that he followed that substituting a feeling for another feeling doesn't work. You never get to feel both feelings properly.
Yeah, but I haven't worked out any other way.
I know, but he knows the other way. It's just that you haven't asked him. Yeah. And you haven't wanted to ask him because...
I thought it's just more feelings I can keep getting.
Correct. Yeah. All right.
Mm.
Now, true joy can only come to you once you've let go of the sorrow and fears that you have inside of you. And the only way you can actually let them go, the way God designed your soul, is that you can, the only way to let them go once they're in you is to experience them.
Oh, but that means you're going to feel pain.
That's correct.
How's that joy?
Well, the problem of what you're currently doing is that the more you tried to avoid this pain, you're actually going to finish up ending up having to feel more pain. Because every time you take an action that's out of harmony with love, the way God's laws work is there's another compensatory effect on your soul. That's what's making you unhappy. So the reason why your happiness is degrading since you began this is because every time you make a choice that harms somebody else's self-free will or is out of harmony with love from God's perspective, every time you do that, it causes a subsequent result inside of yourself for which you'll have to, at some point in the future, feel sorry for.
So you're saying that now I've created more stuff on what I was feeling before.
That's correct.
Well, that's just not right.
That's what you've done. You didn't know you were doing it. And because you were driven mostly by your addictions or mostly by the feeling that you wanted to get certain feelings met within yourself and you didn't really, shall we say, you didn't really care very much how it affected other people.
But would it matter to God if he knew that I didn't know?
Of course it matters. It's a lot worse than if you do know.
But I didn't know.
I know you didn't know. But the reality is if you take actions that are damaging to other people, whether you know or not, there is a subsequent damage that occurs to your soul.
No, that's not fair.
Well, it is fair. Because how would you ever stop otherwise?
Oh, yeah. True.
Right? So it's a bit like, you know, through your reading of history when you were going to school, historically, there's been people like Stalin, Hitler, those kind of people, right?
Yeah, I'm not like them.
Well, let's have a look at the situation. I'm not saying that you're like them, but let's look at the situation. Why didn't they know what they were doing was wrong?
Yeah, I never thought about that. Like, what would their childhood be like?
Mm-hmm.
What caused them to become the person they were? Yeah. They must have been sad and angry about something.
Well, you think about someone like Hitler, he's caused pain and suffering for many, many millions of people, a whole Second World War.
I read something that he was, he was treated badly by his mum.
Well, he was, but it's the choices we make after that point that determine where we go. You see, I can be treated badly by somebody, but actually decide that I don't want to treat people badly. And as a result, I don't have to be in a terrible place and I don't have to harm other people. Yeah. Or I can be treated really badly and then decide to treat other people badly.
I mean, I didn't want to treat anyone badly. I didn't know.
Well, see, now I can't agree with you 100% on that situation. You said to me at the beginning of this conversation that you knew that you were influencing people beyond what they would normally go.
Yeah.
So you can't really say that you didn't know that you were forcing or trying to force a person into doing something they wouldn't normally do.
But that changed. Mm-hmm. As you probably know, since you seem to know a lot of stuff. But when I initially started, I didn't have that motivation to harm anyone.
No. But why did that motivation begin within you? Can you feel the reason why? Can you feel that it was you weren't feeling satisfied by how far you were going?
And yeah, so things changed.
So you see, already you become a little bit sad in that process.
Mm.
And then you decided to try harder to influence people. And then try harder, and then try harder, and then try harder, and try harder. You see, if you keep going down this road, then you'll be influencing people left, right, and centre to do things they don't want to do.
So you're saying these people didn't want to have these things done, even though they're partying?
No, I'm saying that some of them do want it, but as you know, some of them don't. Some of them feel terrible afterwards.
Yeah.
So that's an indication that they don't.
But the only time I started feeling this was when sex was involved.
Yeah.
And it felt yucky, you know, some... Yeah, I can see what you mean, though.
Yeah.
But that feels awful too.
Yes, but this is what I'm saying. You see, if you hadn't done that in the spirit world, then you wouldn't feel awful now while I'm having a chat with you about it. Can you see the feeling of feeling awful is the direct result of making the choice that was out of harmony with love?
Mm.
And what I'm trying... I'm not trying to make you feel bad, but what I'm trying to help you see is the relationship between making a choice that's out of harmony with love and the subsequent effect of that choice, which is sadness.
So
it's important that you see the relationship.
See, if I was to look back at my life when I was on Earth, now I'm struggling to work this out. How? So I was sad because of things I did in my life for 15 years.
No, on Earth it was a bit different because you were sad because of what other people did to you. Does that make sense?
So it can happen in another way.
Yes, I'm saying, but the reality is God doesn't attribute those things to you when other people did them to you.
Oh.
Right?
But I'm still carrying that though.
You're carrying the sadness, but all you need to do is feel the sadness. God doesn't require anything else of you. You don't. In other words, all you need to do is feel the sadness. You don't have to go through feeling sorry about what you did. You just need to feel sad about what happened to you.
Well, I've got a question for you.
Sure.
If you talk about love and it comes from God,
why
didn't God's love stop that coming from me if I didn't create it? Is someone else who's... Oh.
Yeah, see, it's all about the use of your will, which you've been experimenting with for the last 5 years.
Yeah, I know. It just dawned on me.
Yeah. Can you see how you've chosen to use your will...
To do that to someone else.
Yeah, out of harmony with love. And other people chose to use their will out of harmony with love on you.
Why does love allow this to occur?
Love gives the free will gift, but love doesn't allow it to occur. If your parents truly loved you, they would never have done to you what they did.
Love's not a focus on Earth.
I agree.
Love's not a focus here.
I agree. When
not what I mean talking to you, but I mean...
But where the man that you've been talking to lives, it is a focus. Everything in the spirit world above where you are is focused around love. And this is what he's trying to illustrate to you. While you hold on to the earthbound concept of love, which is not love at all, but rather codependent addiction. In other words, me getting from you something I want and you getting from me something you want. That's not love. But that's what people on earth tell you love is.
Yeah, that's what...
And that's not God's definition of love at all. See, the man that you've been speaking with, he doesn't feel that way, does he?
No,
he doesn't feel like he wants anything from you.
He doesn't want anything from me. He just wants to show me.
Exactly.
But he never talked about love either.
Why do you think that might be?
I don't think I really cared about the word itself.
Yeah.
Or what it even meant.
Yeah. And at the time, you were so focused on getting the feelings that you wanted that you probably wouldn't have heard, would you?
So that would have precluded that.
Correct. Unless you really want to know something in the spirit world, you won't know. You won't find out.
But why is love conditional on that? Like, why would love have these preclusions if you...
Well, God's given you the gift of free will. You're allowed to use your will however you decide.
And I've done that.
You have, but you're using your will in a manner that's actually degrading your condition. It's making you sadder. It's making you less happy. You're having to do more and more things to other people that they don't want to have happen in order for you to be happy. And every time you come out of it, you feel worse.
So what's that lesson? Like, what's...
So what God's lesson there is every time you use your will out of harmony with love, there will be more pain.
Right.
That's the lesson.
What? So I learned to become more loving.
So that you decide that you want to be.
You see, for myself.
For yourself, yeah.
So I stopped doing this.
So you stop doing these things and you decide for yourself that you want to be more loving.
Right.
Does that make sense? And you decide that you want to be more loving because you decide you want to be happier. You realise, see, this is why I'm trying to help you see the relationship between your actions and the degrading happiness that you're experiencing. Your actions, because they're out of harmony with the loving use of your will, cause you to feel less satisfied and more unhappy. And what I'm suggesting to you is that you can go the other direction.
But in a way, that's a harsh way to learn.
Well, it is, but how else would anybody ever have been able to convince you that there was another way?
Well, why didn't God just say, stop? Hey, I'm here.
Because God doesn't control your will. If God did that, then God would be just like your mum and dad.
Yeah, I don't want God to be like that.
Exactly. Who wants God to be like that? God doesn't want to control your will. What God wants for you to realise and learn is that you need to learn that if you use your will to love, everything will become happier. And if you use your will in the way you have been, which is very, very self-oriented, then you'll become unhappier.
But that's so subtle. It's not.
Would you say it's subtle? Does the feelings you're feeling now about it feel subtle?
No, I don't mean the consequences of it.
Mm-hmm.
The consequences don't feel subtle at all.
No, it feels pretty painful, don't they?
I mean, to learn that aspect of the consequence of what you're doing
mm-hmm.
whilst you're doing it is subtle.
Yes, I agree.
I wasn't aware of it.
But isn't that better than having someone with a stick or having someone yelling and screaming at you like your parents did? Or do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, in a way I do, but in another way it means that you do all this damage and then...
Well, you only did the damage because you chose.
Yeah, I know, but for so long.
I know, but that's your choice too.
But
how can you then say it's not?
Yeah, no, but the whole earth, everyone who lives does this.
But that's not a justification for unloving behaviour.
I know it's not a justification, but...
But you've just made it one.
Why do I do that?
Because you want to avoid the pain of the result.
Yeah, I don't want to feel the result of it.
Yeah, and what I'm suggesting is you need to feel the pain of it.
I don't want God to give this to me.
God hasn't given it to you, you've given it to yourself. You broke the law, and as a result, there is a consequence. The laws are just a lot more loving than your parents' laws. Your parents had terrible laws, and hardly any of them were loving, right?
But in a way, this feels like, you know, I'm being forced into admission of what I've done.
You are. Isn't that a good thing?
But you say it's a good thing.
Well, wouldn't you have liked to have done that with your parents? to force them into admission that they were terrible parents and they
didn't. But I was terrified to do that.
I know, but wouldn't you have liked to have done that?
Yeah, but...
So why wouldn't God be trying to do that with your parents right now?
Oh. Oh, but that doesn't make it any feel better.
See, God's trying to do that with every one of God's children. God's trying to get everyone to see what they're doing.
Well, and how that'll take ages.
Well, God's got plenty of time. And so have you, if you think about it, because death didn't really happen, did it?
Well, no.
Because you're still alive.
Could I die again?
Well, no.
So then that... Yeah, I don't want to be stuck with all this for the rest of my life.
Yeah. So the reason why you came to me and have this discussion was because you had a nice, friendly man who didn't want anything from you. He was a young-looking guy. And by the way, perhaps we need to ask him how old he is.
Oh, now I don't understand. It's a different person.
How old is he actually?
He's over a couple hundred years old.
Correct.
How's that possible?
Because his body looks young, right?
He says he prefers the young age.
Yeah, yeah.
And then he can help people like me. He Correct. Loves to help people like me.
Yeah.
Why would you love doing that?
How's that because give you he's happiness? Found what being happy really means. And he's tried what you're doing, and it didn't work very well for him either. You look back at the time when he passed, right? It was like a couple of hundred years ago. What did he do after he passed?
Oh, wow. He did similar things.
Yeah, he went to parties, didn't he?
Yeah.
There's a bit more probably partying now than there was then in terms of possible. So he had to spend a lot of his time with rich people on earth who were partying.
Yeah, there were different parties.
Different types of parties, but they were quite decadent.
Oh, they still had sex involved.
Yeah. But it was quite decadent in the sense that they...
Less violence, yes.
Less violence, but they harmed a lot of people in the process.
Hmm.
And what happened to him? Can he show you what happened to his condition?
He said he went a lot further than I did.
Yeah.
He was very black and dark.
Yeah. And he became more and more unhappy.
He was very unhappy. He hid from everyone for a very long time.
Yeah, that's what happened. He eventually got so unhappy that he couldn't go to the parties anymore.
I feel sorry for him.
Yeah. He couldn't go to the parties anymore and he just hid in the spirit world. Until what happened?
Until someone came to him.
Yeah. And when did they come to him?
He said he actually started to cry.
Yeah. When he started to feel his emotions.
Yeah, he was very angry.
Yeah.
And cursed a lot.
Yeah. And it was only when he started to cry about what was going on for him that somebody came to him, right?
But somehow he said, when he was yelling, the word God came out.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's where this person came before him.
Yeah. Yeah. And so when he notices people like you doing what you're doing, he's aware that he did that and his own condition got worse and worse and worse and worse. So he's trying to assist you to have that not happen. Does that make sense? He's trying to say to you, don't do that because that's just going to make you worse. You know, it's going.
There's only one person out of. What about all my other friends?
Well, I would suggest to you that your other friends aren't friends. They're all people who want to do the same that you're doing, but that doesn't necessarily make you their friend.
How do you define friendship then?
Well, a friend is a person who wants to tell you the truth and who wants to help you become more loving and a person who wants to help you experience real happiness.
Like him?
Yeah. Your other friends are just helping you get darker and darker, just like his other friends did. If you look, you know, let him show you some pictures of his mates that he did this with.
Oh, some of his mates are still not, haven't moved.
That's right, yeah. Still dark, unhappy.
Still doing it.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, I don't want to go that far.
Yeah. And you can see they're influencing people to harm other people, kill other people.
Yeah, they're not partying anymore.
No, they're so dark now that they're...
So these people were partying before, now they're actually... They're taking pleasure in harming people.
Yeah, that's correct.
Like in a real...
Well...
Massacre...
Yeah, they're taking
pleasure in a sadistic way.
Yeah, they're taking pleasure in people killing other people and murdering other people and cutting other people up. And
these are girls too.
Yeah, yeah. The girls and boys.
Oh, wow. And voice, yeah.
Yeah. And this is the trouble with this slow degradation, is eventually you take actions that you don't...
But when is it going to stop for them?
Well, when they realise that they're doing it all for the same thing I'm trying to explain to you, that's when it will stop. They're doing it all because they're being selfish and they're being motivated by some feelings they're trying to avoid, just like I'm suggesting you are. Does that make sense?
So self-gratifying feelings.
Yeah, they're looking for self-gratification, but no self-gratification will be extreme enough for them to be satisfied because they take actions that are out of harmony with love, and every time you do that, there is less joy.
Oh, I don't want to do this then. What feelings should I be looking for?
Well, this is...
you said it's based on my decisions.
Yeah, there's two things I feel. And maybe if I just have a cough first, I'll just turn off the sound, so do that.
That's okay, I'm still here.
Yeah.
I was just... I had to take some time to look at... Josh is his name.
Yeah.
He says I'm doing okay.
Yeah? Yeah, because you're finding it a hard conversation, but you're sticking with it.
It's very hard. This isn't easy.
No, I know. I know. So can I explain to you what's going on? Every time that you take an action that's out of harmony with God's viewpoint of love, you feel more pain inside of yourself and feel less happy.
Mm. And how does that happen? Like, how does God's love do that to me? Like,
it's not God's love that does that to you, although it is a loving thing. It is God's laws that do that to you. See, you're not aware, but you're actually breaking some of God's laws. Right, and one of the laws you're breaking is the law of free will, for example. You're trying to influence other people beyond their own will to do things for you so that you can have a selfish outcome.
Okay.
And that's really what your parents did with you. Perhaps not to the same degree, but it's still what your parents did with you. But it's going to cause your gradual degradation until you get to the point, if you're not careful, where you're taking actions that are extreme, even what you now see as extreme, and you still won't be happy. In fact, you'll be worse. You're feeling more unhappy and more angry.
I mean, can I ask you something?
Sure.
I don't think I've ever asked them what their feelings are.
Of course you haven't, because you've only been interested in how it relates to you.
And I can only feel a certain feeling from them. How come I can't feel what their real feelings are?
Well, what you're feeling from them is their addiction. And so, you respond to their addiction. That's what I call a codependent addiction.
So how do I honour a person's free will if I can't feel what they... If all I can feel is their... What do you call it? Codependent
addictions, yeah.
That's something that we share in together.
Yeah,
that's right.
That's right. It's something that you give them and they give you, and you both think you're happier, but you're not. So all of these children, these teenagers that you're influencing and young adults that you're influencing... Do they look happier after the
thing? No, they want more of it as well.
Of course, and they feel sadder. And do you notice the brightness of their bodies? Have you noticed that ever?
Well, they're not as bright as Josh.
No, but have you noticed the brightness after they've done something they didn't want to do?
Oh, they feel sick after.
Yeah.
And they look sick too.
Yeah, that's right. So the brightness of their own bodies is degrading, right?
Yeah, they need to recover.
Yeah. And you've been a part of creating that. So let's get back to what you can do about that.
Mm.
Okay, so what can you do? Well, the first thing you can do is learn this really important lesson.
Well, leave them alone.
Not necessarily, because you can also influence a person positively, but you wouldn't do it against their will. But let's talk about the use of your will.
Okay.
All right. The important lessons that you've had to learn, number one, is that whenever you use your will to get something selfishly met from another person, it's going to cause a degradation of your own happiness.
So then I need to look at... Can you say that again?
Whenever you use your will out of harmony with love,
so
in a selfish
way...
I want
a feeling.
You want a feeling.
But I've got to feel that it's a selfish feeling.
Well, no, you do have a selfish feeling.
Oh.
In other words, you want... You know, I'm not, so don't misunderstand me here. Whenever you use your will out of harmony with God's view of love.
You say, how do I know that's
harmony? Well, you can easily find that out, and we'll talk about that in a minute.
Okay.
But this is a lesson you need to learn.
Right.
That every time you use your will out of harmony with God's, what God knows to be loving, you are going to cause more sadness for yourself and more sadness for other people. This is exactly what your parents did with you, and that's why you arrived in the spirit world in a lot of sadness.
In a way, I'm scared to even look at myself now.
That's okay. That's okay.
So everything I've done so far, that's caused how I feel and what I got from my parents.
Yeah, be careful. There's two things. One thing is what your parents did to you, and God doesn't blame you for those things.
And that was out of, would you say, harmony?
That was out of harmony with love. So that would be attributed to their soul.
What do you mean by harmony? Because that's a nice feeling as well, isn't it? It's supposed to be.
Well, what I mean by harmony is that it's out of being, it's not loving to take the actions that your parents took towards you. You didn't feel it was loving, did you? Felt like you were being controlled. You felt like you were being manipulated.
I felt like it wasn't.
Felt like you were being told what to do all the time, and nobody asked you what you wanted.
Didn't care for me.
Do what you wanted. Nobody cared about what you wanted. So there was a lot of feelings that you felt, right?
Mm.
And all of that is attributed to them.
Okay, so that wasn't loving what's coming from them.
They weren't loving towards you, and as a result, they will have to bear the consequence of that in their soul.
But there's a price that I'm paying for that too.
Only because you refuse to feel your pain about it.
All right, okay. All right.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's a difference, yeah.
Because you've refused to feel your pain about it, you've decided to take actions like your parents. See, if they had realised what they were doing and they said, oh, we're treating Jess badly because we don't want to feel our own pain. If they had realised that, then they wouldn't have done to you the things they did.
And then I wouldn't have received these feelings that I didn't want to feel.
That you don't want to feel.
Okay.
Now, so they chose to not feel their feelings of what was done to them, and instead they chose to act upon their feelings and to do the similar things or harsh things to you.
And then I took it on.
You took that on, and then you did the same as what they're doing. You decided to not feel the pain of the feelings they created in you, and instead you decided to go and get some feelings created with other people, which caused them pain as well.
So now there's a penalty.
Correct. Now there's a penalty associated with it. That's called the law of compensation.
And I've got these feelings in there.
And the sad feelings that you have about it are the penalty. That's what the law gives you in order for you to see that you're doing the wrong thing.
So some of the feelings I've been feeling before I came to talk to you, before I met Josh, is that those feelings?
Yeah, that's those feelings, those law of compensation feelings.
Because they are different to what I feel from, what I got from mum and dad.
Correct. Yeah. So there's two types of feelings. There's the sad things that happened to you from mum and dad that you didn't want to feel. And you're not blamed for those things. You just need to feel them. Does that make sense? Because your parents are blamed for them. From God's perspective, they are to blame for what they did. But when you chose to ignore your own sadness and then chose to harm other people, now God's laws say, right, Jess is to blame for those actions.
See, you say I chose, and this is where I'm finding it a little bit hard.
Yeah.
In a way.
Because you think your addictions aren't a choice.
Yeah, like I feel compelled to do it.
Correct. But
and how do you can...
The reason why you were compelled is because you were avoiding an emotion.
And you call that a choice?
That's a choice. So you could have chose to feel the emotion and then you wouldn't have been compelled to avoid it.
Well, that's a big I feel, man, so this sadness really does drive this other compulsive feeling.
Correct. That's what I'm saying to you. And the compulsions will disappear once you let yourself feel the sadness. Now, that's one thing you need to do. Does that make sense?
Okay.
So what you will find is if you allow yourself to feel the sad feelings from your childhood, then you won't feel compelled to go out and damage other people. So that's important for you to understand.
So that's the only way that's going to stop.
That's the only way it's going to stop. All right? And if you choose to not feel your sadness, then you're going to be compelled to go out and get your sadness met through some other action.
But I still feel... all right. Because I'm not feeling that, I'm feeling compelled still.
Correct. That's the reason why you're compelled. So a compulsion isn't joy, by the way.
No, it's not.
And it feels like you're being led by something that you have no control over.
Like I have to do it.
Yeah, you feel like you have to. So that's not joy.
Okay.
Right? Now, the second thing is this use of your will, remember?
Mm-hmm.
So what was the lesson about the use of your will?
It's my choice.
Every time you choose to use your will to do something that's unloving,
there'll be a consequence.
There'll be a consequence.
I'll get another feeling.
You'll have another feeling that's sad, another feeling that feels painful. Does that make sense? That you'll have to bear and feel at some point in the future.
So my choice in that case, will it always be driven by these sad feelings initially that I've had?
Well, right at the moment, all of your choices are driven mostly by these sad feelings. So even your choice to come and talk to me was driven partially by the sad feelings that have built up in you over the last 5 years. Because 5 years ago, I was still around and you didn't want to come to talk to me then, right? Because you didn't even want to know about those sad feelings.
But this is important. Like,
oh, of course it's important.
I didn't know any of this stuff.
I understand that, and this is why we're trying to teach as much of it as possible, you see?
Hmm.
Yeah, it's all important stuff. So there was this, firstly, this thing about the use of your will. That's a very important thing for you to understand. And you can experiment with that if you want. You can go and do some more damaging things to other people and then feel what you feel about it. And you go, wow, that didn't feel good, you know. And you can work out that's what I'm saying to you is true, right?
Yeah.
The other thing is that you are not blamed for the things that were done to you. You are only responsible for the things that you've done that are out of harmony with love. The things that you chose to do to harm other people.
But I have feelings about those things.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't feel like I haven't got a choice in it.
This is what a compulsion... See, this is why I call addictions. You could call them compulsions.
But even the feelings that, you know, came from my parents, I still feel like I'm to blame for that.
Yes, but that is not true. That is not true.
But it's still a feeling I
feel. It's a feeling you have that you need to feel, but you'll learn as you feel it that it's not true. You'll feel that you'll come to see that the reason why you feel the way you do is because of the way they treated you, not because you were a bad person or anything like that.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Sorry, I confused you.
Okay. You'll come to see God's truth on every matter eventually. So God's truth is on whatever your parents did to you, they are wrong in doing. Every time they did something unloving to you, they were wrong.
Mm.
That's God's truth. But every time you do something unloving to another person, you're wrong. That's also true.
And I'm unloving.
Every time you avoid pain of your own, you will probably cause pain in other people. That's also true. So the key is to allow yourself to feel your own pain, and then it gets released from you. Remember I said like you're like carrying a big bag of pain around.
You know, but how do you do something like that?
Well, this is
it's not easy to feel that stuff.
No, I agree. I've done a lot of it myself and it's not easy. I understand that. And the man that... what's his name?
Josh.
Josh knows that it wasn't easy for him either, doesn't he?
Yeah, he knows. I mean, I don't know how he did it.
But he made the choice to do it. You see, he decided he wanted to.
But he's braver than I am.
Well, not necessarily. You see, he was introduced to a third thing that I'd like to introduce you to. He was introduced to God.
Yeah, well, see, that just challenges me.
Yeah, because you don't believe in God, right?
No.
No. Why don't you believe in God?
Have you been in a boarding school where they talk about God all the time?
I've observed many.
It's crap.
Yeah, I agree.
But they punish us in the name of God.
Yeah, but that's not what I think is God. See, what you're doing again is you're attributing what parents and teachers and stuff did to God, and it's not God's fault that they chose to do those things.
Hmm.
You see, it's their fault they chose to do those things, right?
Yeah, but it's just my feelings about it.
Exactly. See, even your feelings about God preclude you at the moment from considering that there is a God or that there is a God who loves you.
Yeah, I don't want to accept that there is a God. I didn't want to accept there was one.
Yeah. Now, Josh has learned through his process that there is a God.
Yeah, he actually screamed God's name.
Mm. And once he started working through the issues with God, he wanted to receive some of God's love.
But see, it occurred when Josh was in so much pain that he sought God.
Correct.
But why didn't Josh see God before that?
Because he was going through the same experience you were, and that he was being more and more selfish, more and more searching for his addictions being met, more and more avoidance of his own emotions, more and more avoidance of everything. And he was going down this down this terrible road. And it wasn't until the pain of that road got so great.
Yeah, he was in so much despair.
That he decided to call out to God, right?
But is that what people do? Only when you get to so much despair?
Unfortunately, yes. It doesn't have to be that way.
Oh.
It doesn't have to be that way. So you can arrest your current path now.
Oh, can I?
You could stop it now. You don't have to go into the amount of pain he was in. You can stop it right now, but only by doing the things that I'm suggesting to you. Does that make sense?
Mm.
And so far, I've suggested two things for you. One is that you're going to have to learn to feel your own pain. And there's two types of pain. There's a type of pain, feel your own pain about what other people did to you that you're not to blame for. And feel the type of pain that you did to others that you are to blame for. Does that make sense? And you're going to have to be willing to do that.
I mean, I hear you.
Mm-hmm.
I see Josh.
Mm-hmm.
I hear him. I can see he's different. I can see you're both different.
Yeah. So?
How do I know that's going to happen for me?
Well, it's happened for both of us.
But you guys, you know, maybe you know something that's...
No, I'm only telling you what I know.
So everyone can do this?
Everybody can do this. Every one of your friends there who've been going around party to party to party, they can all do this. They can all stop the process that they're going through. See, at the moment, they're getting darker and darker to condition, going down, 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 down. And to be honest, it's called going down into the hells. You know, eventually you look at Josh and where he was in a lot of pain.
I don't want to be in hell.
You don't want to be there. Does that make sense?
Mm.
What you want to do is stop the process now and work out how to do that. And I'm trying to explain to you how to do that. So the first way was... Look at your will, the relationship between if you use your will in an unloving way and you hurt other people, then of course that's going to cause you more pain and them, but cause both of you more pain. If you use your will in harmony with love, from God's perspective, you will receive more pleasure. Does that make sense?
What does that pleasure feel like? Could you explain that at least? Maybe that will give me a bit more motive.
I'm not going to be able to explain it unless you let yourself feel it. So can I suggest something? What I want to suggest will help you feel some of that pleasure.
Okay.
Sound all right to you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. I'd rather do that.
All right. Now, let's assume that God isn't the kind of God that you've grown up with, being browbeaten into by the church.
Mm, okay.
All right. Let's assume God's a very different person.
Is a person?
Or a being.
Being.
Okay. A being. A being who loves, let's assume that. Because
mm-hmm.
if God didn't love, then God would probably be very angry with you at the moment and God would have already punished you. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's true.
Right? So the fact is that God must be much more loving than the average person, otherwise God would already be harming you, just like your parents were.
Mm.
Does that make sense, logically?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So let's assume that God's a God of love.
Okay.
And God has some love to give you.
Mm.
But there is only one condition that has to be satisfied for you to receive it.
What's that?
You need to long for it. You need to want it.
I have to want it.
You've got to want it.
But how do I want it?
That's the key question. How have you wanted other things?
I've been compelled.
No, that's not wanting it. That's an addiction. You think of the thing, is there any time in your life where you actually wanted something that you weren't compelled?
Yeah.
When?
When I was young.
When you were young, what did you want? And you weren't compelled, you weren't sort of like feeling like you were pulled along into it?
It's not easy to talk about.
Yeah.
I just wanted to be hugged and...
Okay.
And loved.
Yeah. Now, if you feel that feeling towards God... then you will have some of God's love into you.
But it makes me feel sad.
Well, it will, because God's love will expose any sadness that you have within you. And you just need to have a cry about that. That's fine. Every time I long for God's love, I cry.
To you.
Yeah.
It's not an easy thing to do.
No, because you've got to let yourself feel your emotions.
But I start shaking when you say that.
It's because you're a bit afraid.
Mm.
What are you afraid of?
What happens if I can't handle these feelings?
But God created you to handle feelings. If you trust God, you would understand that.
But I don't trust God.
I know.
But it means I've got to do something, trust in something I don't know.
No, you don't have to trust in something you don't know. You just need to have a longing for God's love and let yourself feel it when you feel it. Do you see what I'm saying? That's all you need to do.
And Josh did this.
Josh did this. And it helped him connect to many of his emotions as well. Does that make sense?
Okay. But it's instant. I automatically start feeling sad. Yeah. When I do this.
Yeah. But notice what else is happening around you.
I don't want to look. I don't want to open my eyes.
Why don't you open your eyes? Have a look.
Oh, things are a bit different.
Mm-hmm. What's different?
I'm leaving this place.
Yeah. You see, what's been happening is you've been bound to earth because of your addictions. And what that means is that you haven't been able to go and experience the many beautiful places that are much more beautiful than earth.
Wow.
Right? These places are a lot more beautiful, but they're all dependent on you being in a better condition of love. In other words, they're all dependent on you being more loving.
But this is the stuff I wanted to know when I passed.
Yeah, yeah. But remember, you had some opportunities to ask the question when you passed, but the addictions got in the way. You felt compelled to go down a different track for a while.
And oh, what a waste of time.
It is a waste of time, yeah. Yeah. But you learned some things. You learned that if you decide to take actions that are out of harmony with love, in other words, you decide to be unloving, that you would eventually feel the pain of that. And that's not a bad thing to learn.
Actually, you're right. It's not that bad. It's strange. I didn't think I'd feel a little bit more relaxed.
Yeah.
After I have a cry.
Can you see that you've let go of a bit of grief, right? And now you feel a bit better?
Yeah.
Yeah?
It is. It's really strange.
Yeah, it is strange. But it's true, isn't it? Now you're carrying less in the bag. It's like what you've done, you know, the big bag of grief.
Josh is just laughing.
Yeah. Because he knows about all this.
Yeah, right? He's cracking a joke. Sorry.
Yeah. So you had a big bag of grief and you just took a little bit of it out and put it outside.
Oh, I didn't do it.
No, you felt it. It was you doing it.
And I do feel lighter.
Yeah. You chose to do it, and you also had a longing for God's love in that moment. Remember I reminded you of that feeling of wanting to be hugged?
Yes.
Just imagine that the person you want the hug from is God.
Yeah, that's not so hard to do, actually. Mm. Mm.
And if you allow that process to occur, you'll feel lighter, you'll feel less sad. You'll go to different locations in the spirit world that are much happier and better than any place on earth that you could have ever visited.
So is that
and the parties are better, by the way.
But they're not going
to be. But yeah, they're parties, but they're not going to be like the kind of parties you've been going to.
But does that mean I'll feel that for myself?
Yes, you'll feel all of those feelings for yourself, rather than through another person.
So,
and a lot of the feelings will feel very raw. But they'll also feel satisfying.
So if I go to this place, I'm scared that I may be compelled to harm another.
You are feeling compelled to harm another, remember what you have to do?
Just feel why I'm sad.
Exactly.
Then I'll stop my choice.
Then you'll be able to make a different choice, yeah. Because it's all about the choices you're making in your feelings, right? At the moment, what you've been doing up until now is every time you had a feeling that compelled you to go and do something, you just went along and did it without thinking about what choice am I making here? Is this loving to that person?
So every time you got stuck, you just longed, what do you call it? Longing. You wanted God's love.
Wanted God's love. And also had a look at my choices.
And you looked at
You see.
So you always got to go back and have...
And allow myself to feel make the choice to allow yourself to feel your own pain rather than doing something else with it. See, most people on earth don't do that. What they do is they have a whole lot of bottled up pain inside of themselves. So instead of feeling it, what do? They do what your parents did. They take it out on someone else.
Yeah, well, they look for other things to make them feel so they don't feel.
Exactly. So they substitute, just like you tried.
I never knew that.
Yeah. They're the two things that you do.
So I can actually feel some of those feelings that those people had.
Yeah.
But I never knew that was there.
Yeah.
Wow.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So what they're doing is they have pain. They don't want to feel their pain. So what they try to do is they either substitute, they try to get some pleasure to substitute for the pain, or they avoid their pain altogether and try to harm somebody else in order to feel better about themselves, and both things don't work.
So it's the same feelings that they're having as we are.
Correct.
As I am having here.
Correct.
Nothing different.
Nothing different.
It's just they don't want to feel the feelings, the
That's
sad.
Right. That's right. Yeah, they don't want to feel the feelings.
Oh. This isn't so hard.
No. But you probably feel it's not so hard because you've already received some of God's love, right?
Yeah. Okay, I've received love.
Yeah.
That is sad as me.
Yeah.
For a different reason.
Yeah.
Because I'm happy.
Yeah, exactly. So have a good cry about that too. That's fine.
So is this what you guys were talking about?
Yeah.
The happiness.
Yeah. And that feels a lot more real, doesn't it? Because it's your own.
Yeah, it's me.
Yeah. Yep.
I've got to go.
No worries.
So thank you.
It's lovely talking to you, Jess. Just let yourself have a good cry.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Bye.
Bye.
You know, it's funny, I've been thinking about, not just thinking, I've actually been drawn all of a sudden to the soul talks. And like, wow, you hit some really hard points in there. And
yeah.
It's been pretty good in the last couple of days about listening, just to listen to that and to realise.
Yeah.
The amount of suppression.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So for this girl, basically what's happening is that she suppresses her own pain. As a result, she's seeking pleasure somewhere else. But the places where she's seeking pleasure are not real pleasure, they're just addictions.
They're addictive feelings.
And that feeling of being compelled is the indication of an addiction. Whenever you feel drawn or compelled, that's an addiction. And whenever you feel drawn or compelled in that direction that she was going, you end up feeling worse.
You do. And you also feel the spirits with you at that time as well. They're pushing you as well.
Of course, because they want to develop your compulsion into something even darker. And that's what happened to Josh. Like his compulsion got developed into something so dark that eventually he was in so much pain that he just cried out for it to stop, and that's when it stopped. But until then, he was just associating with people who were very, very dark and getting darker by each time that he engaged another operation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's sad, eh?
No, it's amazing how addictions work. Like, yeah. It is that feeling that I can understand.
Yeah.
Well.
And that's the important thing for the spirits to understand. You see, a lot of the times after they pass, they feel drawn or compelled. They feel pulled into a place instantly without understanding that it's all a compulsion. So therefore, it's an addiction. And it's all driven by the avoidance of something emotional.
What happened to her when she passed? Like, did she get through the mist and to...
No, what happened? No, she's not been through the mist.
She hasn't had
She all. Died.
Yeah.
Right? She drowned. She went to the spirit world. The group of them, the girls, died together, and they're all her friends. So they're now all earthbound spirits who all have the compulsion. They had a very suppressed, it was a Catholic upbringing, very suppressed Catholic upbringing, and they all felt the compulsion to just go and do whatever they could do. And so initially they had a few questions, but those questions didn't last very long in their mind because their compulsion drew them. And their compulsion drew them straight away to go and do some things that they couldn't do when they were alive, that they weren't allowed to do when they were alive.
And that's all they were concerned about?
That's all they were concerned about. So all they did for the last 5 years is that. just going around from party to party to party to party, trying.
And you could actually feel that drive in them. Like it's
yeah. It's, but not only was that driving them, but they decided to do each party because the feelings weren't satisfying. Each party, they decided to influence people more and to do worse things at each party. Yeah. Does that make sense? And so now they're getting driven to do worse things, and they're trying to drive people on Earth to do worse things. And as a result, their own condition starts degrading, and they start feeling the pain of their condition degrading.
Okay.
And that's the feeling she described of feeling dissatisfied, not feeling any joy, feeling no matter how much she tried to get the addiction met, that the addictions weren't getting met, and it wasn't feeling satisfying to have them met either. And what I was trying to do in the discussion was try to connect her to the fact that her addictions were driving her, and that no matter how much they drive you, you will not feel satisfaction. And that's a very important thing.
Up
because
until
if a
what
person
point?
Doesn't understand that, they'll just keep going and going until they're in so much pain that they've got to stop.
But then the pain's the only thing that stops them.
Yeah. Yeah. For many of them, yes. Many times, though, they have spirits come to them, like Josh, who say, no, this is not the right place for you to go, and they, you know, give suggestions to them, but most people in that place don't listen. They just try harder, try harder, try harder. Yeah.
I'm not too sure that people who went all the way.
That's right. So what I tried to do in that discussion is to show that Josh went all the way.
Yeah.
And by the way, he didn't go all the way. There are some who were Josh's mates who are now involved in massacres, murders,
yeah.
and all sorts of things.
Yeah.
And they've not yet gone all the way. But they've degraded their condition, and they've spent 200 years doing that. Like,
in a way, it's slightly scary, the fact that that can actually occur when you pass.
Yeah.
Like, you think you're in a better state, and when you pass, you're just going to automatically...
But it's all about your decisions.
Be compelled.
And decisions are not like... See, the problem that most people on Earth sort of think that the decisions are sort of like instant. Like, all of a sudden, I ask you to kill somebody, and you go, I can't do that, right? It's not like that. You see, if I first ask you to do one thing, like let's say I first ask you to somehow, you know, just influence a person and push them in that direction, and then I get you to feel the satisfaction of that.
Oh, yeah.
And then I get you to feel like, oh, push them down in that direction. See, you just made them have sex with somebody else. How did that feel for you? Oh, that felt really good. So what's happening is you're being educated to actually take more and more larger actions negatively, and eventually you get to the point where making the next step into murdering somebody is just like making another step. It's not like a huge gap anymore, it's just a little tiny step for you, because everything you've done up to that point has been just about as bad as that. Now, you know, there's movies about that on Earth and stories about that on Earth. Moral stories, I suppose you'd call
them. But even crime scenes, normal legal crime scenes, the perpetrator goes through a series of events.
Exactly.
Until
they make another decision, another decision, another decision. And they end up doing something that they eventually is so painful that they stop, right? Mm. But you know, to get to that point, they've had to make decision after decision after decision after decision negatively out of harmony with love. That's how most of us degrade in our condition. We don't make a big choice all at once. Like Hitler didn't make a choice to kill 45 million people through a war and through genocide of the Jewish race right at once. You know, that decision occurred after other decisions, and eventually you get to the point where you make those kind of decisions. Does it make sense?
Yeah.
And this is the trouble. Most people don't understand that about their will. Every time you exercise your will negatively, you are exposing yourself to the potential of a worse decision later. See, if I don't act upon my negative desires now, then it's highly unlikely if someone presents to me a worse negative thing that I'll actually do it, right? If I instead feel my pain as to why I want to do it, then I definitely won't do it. But for the average person, they don't feel their pain, and what they do is they're given a little, I suppose you could say, it's like having a feast in front of you, negatively, so having a huge feast in front of you, none of which you like, but somebody says, here, just take this one thing. Here, eat that.
Have
and you have that, and you go, oh, yeah, that's okay. And then they say, oh, try this other thing. And then they go, oh, try this thing as well, and try that thing as well. And eventually you're trying things that you would never even consider trying before.
It's like smoking.
Right? and it's very much the same with our moral choices. We often get to the point where we're trying all sorts of things that we would never thought we would eventually try, but it's been a slow process of degradation of our moral condition. And that's what was happening to her. Mm. She was being led down this road of a slow degradation of her moral condition, and it's fortunate she came at this point, because if she didn't come at this point, there would have been more pain and more pain and more pain, and eventually she could have ended up like Josh, having experienced extreme pain, or she could have even ended up like Josh's mates that are still doing it, who have yet to feel any of their pain.
In a way, the visions were very, very similar to what you're saying. It's like I saw visions where eventually she was doing things on her own, trying to influence, then learning, and then there was like three or four people. And then eventually she wanted to start experimenting from drugs and alcohol to sex and other... Yeah.
And then group sex and whatever else, and just trying to get the...
So just enveloped.
And just the decisions getting worse and worse and worse each time. Each time she's using her will to make a negative choice or a negative decision. And eventually that's how you become unstuck morally as an individual.
Mm.
That's how you become unstuck. And there are many spirits in the spirit world who are very aware of how to help a person become unstuck.
So they're playing purely on the person's addiction.
Yep.
The feelings that the self-gratifying feelings.
And the feelings you want to avoid. Remember, all the self-gratifying feelings are all about the feelings you want to avoid.
Mm.
The compulsions that you have. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a pretty sad situation, but that's the way it is, you know, like, and every time we want to avoid an emotion, the next, you know, we're going to be compelled to either substitute or to do an action that helps me avoid the original emotion every single time.
Mm.
Yeah. And it's a good lesson of a lot of the things we've been talking about in the soul with regard to resistance and suppression and what happens to you when you do that. But also about the moral choices you make, you know, like most people are not aware that you can't go from being a person who wouldn't consider murdering to a person who murders without making a series of choices in between.
Mm.
You can't go from being a fairly pure sexually moral person to being a person who's completely degraded morally, sexually, without making a whole series of choices in between. And it's the choices in between. Each one of them is a critical choice, because without you making the next choice, you wouldn't have gone down that road. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So if you stop the choices at each point, you can stop and go, hang a sec, this is a really critical choice for me. If I make the next choice, where am I going to go next? And you can choose to not go there and go, okay, I want to make a different choice now, and I don't have to make this negative choice instead. Does that make sense? And the beauty of doing that is that you now arrest the degraded development that will continue unless you arrest it.
Yeah, so long as you admit that that's the feeling that's occurring right at that point.
Correct. Now, most, unfortunately, are not very sensitive to their feelings of pain. Mm. And so what happens is they make one choice, there's a bit of pain associated with it, but they feel they then are presented with another choice, they make that choice, and then they're presented with another, and then they make that. And before they know it, they've made a choice to go from here down to the hells, you know, even. And they go, how did I get here?
Yeah.
And the way they got there was by making each individual choice that was out of harmony with love. And it's very rare for a person to be presented with a huge choice out of harmony with love. Most of the time, they're presented with little tiny decisions.
I even thought it was quite interesting how you said to her, open her eyes, she didn't even want to look at herself. So during that whole time, she didn't even...
No, she hasn't ever seen herself.
Hmm.
She also, otherwise she would have noticed her degrading condition, actually.
Yeah.
She would have noticed that when she first arrived in the spirit world, she was in, you know, quite a similar condition to her body in real life, on Earth. And she would notice, if she looked at herself now, that it was in a worse condition than that. And she would have recognized, she would have started looking and go, why is this happening? It would have helped her, actually.
Yeah.
But most people who are being compelled to do things in their addictions don't look at themselves, and they don't even want to look at the mirror, and they don't want to see what's going on in their body, and they don't want to see what they're creating in their life, and they don't want to see the pain they're creating in other people, which are all the types of things I was trying to help her see.
Yeah. That was cool.
Yeah.
I enjoyed that one.
Yeah.
Hmm. Others see each other?
Well, see, each person in a group like that sees each other, but they, because they're all the same, it's not like a big shock to them. It's sort of like there's no, they don't automatically presume that that's what they look like. It's like they're being drawn by their compulsions, right? They don't assume that just because, my friend there looks a bit bad, looks like she got worse. There's not enough thought of that, because you're being driven by this feeling that you've got to go ahead and do it anyway, even if you do look worse.
So they dismiss all the other sensory inputs.
The smells. The pain, the terrible colours, all the stuff. Because the compulsion, the addiction, is just pulling you in that direction.
So, you know, have we got all chakras? Mm. Does it also look differently in the spirit body? Like, is it sort of like... from a certain chakra, there'll be an energy coming out.
Yep.
Projecting out.
Yeah, you'd see the energies going out, and then if you were observant, most of them aren't at this point.
So that'll all be focused on the second chakra, for example, in this case.
Yeah, yeah, first and second chakra is just totally focused on that generally, and wanting things through their addiction to feel good about themselves, wanting to feel the sexual feelings coming from another so they can feel good about themselves.
And the way they move around Earth, is that also based on... the correlatory feelings, it just draws them to
it just draws them. Once they feel the feeling that they it's a bit like once you feel a feeling that will be satisfied in a certain situation, you'll be drawn to that situation.
Yeah.
So for example, the average young fellow on the earth who is not with a regular partner, and even most of them who are, and who wants sex regularly, will be drawn to go to a party where women are willing to be, you know, go to bed with them without much consideration, right? They'll be drawn to go there because they know that's where they're going to get their hit, their emotional hit, which is really a sexually driven emotional desire. And they know that's where they're going to get it met, so that's where they'll end up. And it's the same in the spirit world. You'll end up in the locations that will meet the addiction.
It's amazing.
Yeah, it's a bit sad, but...
Yeah.
And we probably should just include all that discussion on the end of the thing if it's still being recorded. Just as an addendum on the back of it.
And I also wanted to ask, then the flip side.
Yep.
So the moment she received love, it was different.
Well, the feeling of God's love is a very real emotional experience, even if it is overwhelmingly powerful and sad for someone in her condition. It's a real experience. It's something she's feeling for herself, right? It's just very, very different to what she's been trying to feel through other people. And because it's a feeling she's feeling for herself, it feels quite different. She can feel now the difference between a feeling that she's having for herself and feelings that she's trying to get met from other people.
Mm.
Yeah. And that makes that has a fairly large impact on a person, because they're realizing, wow, I'm feeling happy all of a sudden. It's overwhelming, I'm crying, feeling happy type of feeling. And that's much more powerful a feeling than I had when I was trying to get all these sexual feelings met through, you know, all of these different earthbound things that I was trying to do.
Yeah, I don't know, sometimes it feels like there's a surety or like a solidness to it.
Yeah, there is.
It gives you more confidence in a way.
It's a much better feeling than getting your addictions met.
So do you feel she'll just continually desire to grow with love?
No, she's going to have to work through many of her compulsions, her addictions, which is going to take her time, and she'll probably go back and forward a bit between the two. The reason why I tried to explain to her the relationship between an action taken out of harmony with love and the result of pain is so that in the future she actually can feel that result whenever, like I said, she's probably going to experiment with it, and she'll feel the results of those experiments. Yeah. So I feel she will probably, you know, she'll try and do what Josh is suggesting, but she'll also have times when she goes back to trying to get addictions met the old way, feeling the pain of that, and there'll be a gradual change over that period of time. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Yeah, cool.
Yeah. So it's it won't be any. And for none of these that we talk to, there is an instant change. There's no such thing as an instant change.
Yep.
If a person's been heavily steeped in addiction
even after they've received some of God's love, they're still going to be drawn to many of their addictions. Mm. And they're going to have to be very sincere about addressing them before they'll change.
Just like us.
Just like we have to be.
I wish it could happen.
Yeah, there's often this interpretation, I think, of mediumship, where people feel like, oh, all of a sudden, you know, they're gone, that's all done now, they're done and dusted. Yeah.
They met their guides, they're off.
Yeah, they're off. It's not the way it is. Yeah. They met some people who are helping them. They can feel the help coming from them. They're a bit more open to the help.
Yeah.
They can feel that these people love them and want to help them. But they still have addictions.
Mm.
And they're still going to have to go through a sincere desire to address them. And they're still going to have to work through all the decisions they made and all the unloving choices they made and all of these things. They're all going to have to be worked through. So there's no like magic pill solution that you instantly changed.
Yeah.
It's nothing like that at all. It's a process that you have to go through. The key is to understand what the process is.
Mm.
You know, for many of them, there's no understanding what the process is. And if you think about it, on earth, for the majority of people, there's no understanding of what the process is either.
In a way, some of the people we meet, like through the mediumship, they do feel that somehow it's easier for the spirits, it's much easier in the spirit world.
Yeah, it's
more. But they're still got to go through the same feelings.
In fact, in some ways, it's a lot harder because you, like with these girls, they could go from place to party to party to party to party, no break at all. They don't have to stop for rest. They don't have to stop for sleep. They don't have to stop for money. They don't have to stop to, you know, work. They don't have to stop to go to school. They don't have to stop to do anything. There's no external controls over it. Now, if you're in that place and you're compelled,
yeah, well,
you can see you can be drawn from place to place to place to place to place without any thought at all about what's really going on.
It's actually quite scary.
So it's actually quite a scary place as well. So yeah, this whole assumption that people have that it's actually easier. No. If you haven't made the connections on earth about your addictions and where they're drawing you and issues of morality, you're going to have a lot of difficulty in the spirit world making those connections. And it's much harder in the spirit world to make those connections because it's so easy to get all of your addictions met.
Mm.
Whereas on earth, it is harder to get your addictions met than it is in the spirit world. Because you're constrained by time,
money.
Space, money.
Food, sleep.
Food, sleep, natural events, all sorts of things.
Yeah, boundaries.
Yeah. Whereas in the spirit world, you're not constrained by any of those things.
So you just...
So it's like a 24/7 free-for-all.
It's like a...
Driven by your addiction. Imagine how hard that is to give up.
I know. Wow.
Yeah.
It's like that movie we watched, Euphoria. What was it? Interstate 60.
Yeah.
And I remember the guy who was driving the car ended up picking up a hitchhiker, and it was a lady, and she wanted to go to a town called Euphoria.
Yeah.
And they took this drug called Euphoria, and the kids were stuck there because they were constantly taking the substance.
Taking the substance,
And they were just always feeling good.
Yeah.
In a way, that reminds me of Euphoria.
Yeah. And they gave away their will.
They gave away their total will.
Their addiction causes... Every time you're in addiction, you give away your will.
Mm.
Yeah. So every time you're compelled by something, you're no longer in control of your own will.
Yeah.
Your compulsion is being drawn by the avoidance. When I say you're not in control, you can control the compulsion as long as you're willing to feel the underlying reason for the compulsion, right? But most people aren't. And so while they're in the state where they're avoiding their underlying reason, they will be in compulsion. And it's almost, to them, it feels like they have no control over it. That's what it feels like. They do have control over it, but they don't feel they do.
Mm.
Because they're unwilling to feel the underlying reason why they feel compelled. So if you pass in the spirit world and you're unwilling to feel pain, man, it can be a very, very hard place. Because you're going to be compelled to avoid your pain. You're going to enter addictions that you'd never thought of entering when you're alive on earth. And as a result, probably degrade your condition even further. And eventually the pain will be so great that you'll stop and you go, maybe I should try a different direction.
How long will that take?
Well, like for Josh's friends, 200 years been doing that and no change.
Mm.
You can do it for hundreds of years. Yeah. And this girl was in danger of doing it for hundreds of years. Because you get to the point where you take actions based on moral decisions that were so out of harmony with love that you're even ashamed of your own choices. Do you know what I mean? Eventually.
Mm.
Yeah. You can justify them anyway. She was justifying most of her choices, wasn't she?
Yeah, she was.
And she couldn't see the relationship between her choices and her parents' choices.
Another thing I always assumed, and I don't know why I made this assumption, but I thought spirits, they do actually progress in a way. They go through the mist and then they have it, they exercise a choice there. No. But some people just don't.
Well, the large majority don't go through the mist.
Mm.
You see, the only people that generally go through the mist are the people who no longer have a desire for anything on earth. So you know the book Through the Mists,
mm.
that describes a man, Fred, who had no desire for anything on earth when he passed.
Yeah.
So as a result, he went through the mist. He was straight away in the spirit world, learning things in the spirit world. And because he loved when he was on earth, like he did things that were loving, he took actions that were loving, he was in quite a good moral condition, he went pretty good as a result, right? But that's not the average experience nowadays. The average experience nowadays is a person passes, they remain earthbound from 5 to 100 years, generally, and then they have degraded their condition and feel more pain. And so because they feel more pain, they've now gone from, you know, their condition when they pass down to a darker condition, they're feeling more pain. The pain gets so great that they stop, then they go to a location in the spirit world. That's what happens for the majority. Yeah.
It's scary.
Yeah, so, the avoidance of pain.
Jump on the pain wagon.
All the avoidance of pain. Who wants to avoid pain?
Everybody.
Everybody. Every time you want to avoid pain, create addiction. Every time you create an addiction, it's a compulsion. Every time it's a compulsion, you're going to be drawn to satisfy the compulsion.
I mean, it feels so stupid at the times, but that's what we do.
We do, yeah. And there's no moral compass in many of us to make a different choice. We go, why wouldn't I make that immoral choice, you know?
You know, I was thinking about, recently I've been doing a lot more just surrender. What does it feel like just to surrender?
Yeah.
It's like, oh, bugger it, I've got it, doesn't matter. And, you know, it actually does work
on
some issues. It's the only problem is I don't allow it.
Well, the key is to surrender to the feeling and the acknowledgement without taking action that's more damaging.
Mm.
So that's where most people come to unstuck. They surrender to the feeling or the emotion, but then in that feeling, they take actions that are more damaging. And that obviously is just going to cause a degradation of yourself further. Yep. So, yeah, you don't want to do that. But that's what most people do when they surrender.
Mm.
But most people don't realise as soon as they pass in the spirit world, there's a high likelihood they'll surrender. And therefore, unless you've got some moral compass that you've developed on earth, you're going to go ahead and do a whole heap of damaging things. It doesn't matter how much divine truth you know, you're just going to go ahead and do it.
Mm.
You go ahead and do it because you're drawn by the addictive compulsion. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think the reality sunk in.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. No, thanks for that.
Anyway.
Thank you.
All right, guys, thanks. Welcome to the Divine Truth Channel again. And myself and Anto have gotten together on another day and doing some more mediumship together. I'm not sure this time what's the background of this one, so let's talk to Anto about the problem or the background of these particular things.
Yep.
So
I've actually got Jess turned up.
Jess, the one we talked to yesterday.
Yep. She's turned up. She just wanted to clarify something.
Sure, so shall we do that first then?
Yeah, if we could just do that.
Yep.
Because Pauline, my guide, brought her along and she wants to just clarify one quick point.
No worries. Yep. So let's do that.
Yeah. Hello again.
Hello, Jess.
I just wanted to say, when you asked me the question of how I died, I actually didn't realise how I died. All I can remember was I was drowning.
Yes.
So when I said what I said in the venue, it was just one of my friends said that and that's what popped in my mind.
Yeah.
So I actually don't know how I've died, so I just want to clarify that.
Right, okay.
If people,
yeah,
start looking around. Yeah, so, and I just felt it was important because...
So have you considered why you don't remember how you died?
Well, obviously it's something I don't want to know about.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See, the way the human soul works is that you actually have a soul, a spirit body and a physical body. So at the moment you're in your spirit body, right? Mm. And when you're on earth, you had a physical body as well. And your spirit body and your physical body were created by your mum and dad, but your soul was created by God. And you're one half of one soul, right?
Mm.
So you're one half of one soul connected to a spirit body and then connected to a physical body when you're on earth. When you died, your physical body died. Does that make sense? But the record of how you died is actually stored in your soul.
Okay.
So somebody else can actually read that record in your soul and tell you how you died, if you want to know how you died.
Again, my will is required.
But again, your will is required, yeah. Right? And this is the beautiful thing about the way God's created will, is that you're allowed to have your will, and you're even allowed to deny how you died. You're allowed to do that. But may I suggest to you, it's like anything, denying it doesn't help the situation. It doesn't help you work through the issues associated with the situation. So it's far better to know than it is to not know.
Yeah, I guess it's just quite overwhelming the first time you start feeling things about things that you don't want to know.
Of course.
That, you know.
Yeah.
It does. It's very confronting.
It is confronting to be overwhelmed emotionally. But eventually you'll get used to being overwhelmed emotionally, and in fact you'll like it after a while.
Well, I am actually curious. So, yeah. I have been told I'll be learning a lot more about things within me.
Yep.
And there are a lot of things that I'll be learning through this process, including what they've told me about this soul. So I am curious about it.
So what I would suggest to you is to look at anything you're afraid of, because usually the things we're afraid of, there's a lot in them. You know, there's a lot of things that there's a lot of ways we can help ourselves if we work through why we're afraid.
They even said that I'll be able to feel what caused my death as well.
Correct.
What led to it. And I'm scared of that, so.
Well, see, a lot of people are scared of it because they think they blame themselves, right? But it's not like that at all. There's usually emotions that are in us from our childhood that eventually caused our death. Does that make sense? And after we know them, we understand our life better. So it's much better to understand them than to not.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll not assume that you all died in a bus in the Andes.
No, it was not me. It was my friend.
It was your friend.
Who I met in the spirit world.
Yeah, and she died in a bus in the Andes.
I mean, I even got confused. There was another friend, a couple of people here.
Yeah.
They're not here right now, but yesterday they were, and they had died in a tsunami. And, you know,
by being drowned.
We all had and I realised that. It's just like, we all drowned, but in our own way.
Yeah.
I hadn't left the country, so.
So you've never left England.
So I drowned. I don't know how I drowned yet, but.
Yeah, you will work through those issues. And my suggestion is to let yourself remember, because in remembering, you'll find out a lot about yourself.
I just didn't want to perpetrate another error.
No, that's good. That's very good.
I don't want to harm anyone else.
That's very good. That's very good.
So thank you again with all my heart. And hopefully you can feel more love for me.
And also feel that you're a bit more connected to how you really feel now, which is really lovely.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, good luck with the processing.
Thanks.